move on straight into new business. So first item is we've got a presentation from Rosa de Castilla Apartments, or on the Rosa de Castilla Apartments. Would you like to?
Should I stand or stand?
However you'd like.
Yeah, my name is Jacqueline Montrosa, and I am here on behalf of East LA Community Corporation. I am here to introduce our project, It's 90 units of affordable housing in the Sereno. The address is 4208 East Huntington Drive South. Just a little bit about ELACC. ELACC is East LA Community Corporation. It's a nonprofit developer, affordable housing developer. We also do community organizing around issues that the community wants to see change. We do tax preparation, foreclosure prevention. We have tenant services included in our buildings. We have approximately 800 units of affordable housing, mostly in Boyle Heights and East LA, but also some now in pre-development in El Sereno. We have one project in El Sereno called Cuatro Vientos that was built in 2012, I believe. That was 25 units of family housing. And we are currently also developing another project in South Huntington. We have approximately 22 years of operating. It's like the organization, and that's a little bit about the organization. As far as the project is concerned, it's again 90 units of affordable housing. It's going to be a special mix of our population. It's going to be 63 units for veteran families, and 25 units for just general low-income families. There's a mix of studios, one, twos, and threes, for area median income of 30% to 50% at the highest level. We have secured some funding, but not all of it. So it would be a project where we would have, because of our tenant population being veterans, we would have New Directions for Veterans, which is a nonprofit service provider on site, as well as an office specific for VA, for the Veteran Affairs Office, to serve our tenants for like case management and day-to-day checking in with them, making sure that their wellness is taken care of. Like a little bit more about the project, it's going to be four stories, and it's going to have underground parking. There's also going to be a small garden in the rear that's going to have like benches and chairs for the residents. Most of the front facade of street level is going to be for services, for offices, office space pretty much for the services for the building, including property management, case management, and two different community rooms. We have started some of the outreach process, just checking in with a couple different groups in the neighborhood, but we intend to do a 6-month community outreach process, also identifying any other community groups that we may have missed or that you may also suggest we reach out. We are starting to, we're gonna be submitting our entitlements application in the next few weeks. And I have here our entitlements consultant to speak a little bit, and I'll let her introduce herself.
Yeah, I'm Sylvia Sacedo with Sacedo Group. I'll be the entitlement consultant for this project, which is named Rosa de Castilla. So you tell me what would make the most sense, what type of information you want on the entitlement side.
So is this a by right development?
You know, it's a funny story, of course. When ELAC first purchased the property, we were all very excited because because it's a C2 zone in the front. So we really thought we were going on a by right project, because for the 90, we actually calculated the 90 units based on the C2 density. So for, if when a site is zoned C2, you automatically are in R4 densities for most of the city. However, this particular property has some very unique constraints to it. It is a 5-acre parcel, 5.5-acre parcel. But the front of the parcel that fronts Huntington Drive, is C2. And that's maybe like 15% of the 5 acres. So it might be like, I believe, 36,000 square feet. So that's the C2 parcel. To the rear of the C2 parcel is an RE20 parcel, and to the rear of that is an A1 parcel. So the thought is, and the plan is, to only build on the C2 parcel to create the less impact on the environment and the less impact on the neighborhood. So to limit the building on the C2 parcel. So initially the thought was this would be a by right project, and by right on the C2 parcel you can construct 90 units. Well, lo and behold, there's a queue condition on the site, and the queue condition limits the density on the C2 parcel to RD 1.5 densities, which means you really can only have 24 units on that 36,000 square foot piece. So in order to get relief, because the project would not be feasible with only 24 units on the site, we're going through the density bonus process, and we are seeking relief from various constraints that are put on the parcel because of the queue condition. So in order to, as a result of that, we are seeking, other than a density bonus off menu incentives, we are seeking a CUP that will allow us to go beyond the 35% density allowed by the density bonus provision. And because we're building more than 50 units, we're in a site plan review process as well. So when we looked at the parcel and we considered the 35% density bonus, that would bring us up to 33 units, which would still make the project not financially feasible. So our goal really was to get to those 90 units that we would have by right, as if the queue condition did not exist. And in order to do that, I believe we're like 275% density, which is with the CUP, which is what we would be seeking under the CUP. Another interesting fact about the site is that it's in a very high fire hazard severity zone, which means that every incentive under the density bonus provision has to be off menu. So now we're entirely off menu for all of our incentives. So because we're utilizing, maximizing the C2 site to have the 90 units or the proposed 90 units, we also thought it would be lovely for our residents to really enjoy part of that hillside. So what we'd like to do is have the garden start at the C2 boundary and flow a bit into the RE20 zone. So that would be an off-menu incentive that we would be looking for. Because of that, we're looking to reduce the setback in the rear to zero, so it's a seamless flow from one zone to the other. We would know it because we're real estate people, and but the residents will not know it because they'll be living there and they'd be able to enjoy the property as well. So we're seeking additional height. We're seeking 5 feet above what the traditional height would be. We would be limited, based on the queue condition, to 45 feet or 3 stories. We would like to go up 50 feet or 4 stories. So we would be looking for that as well. We're looking for a reduction in open space on the C2 parcel, which would be made up by the garden that would also form part of the RE20 parcel. We're seeking relief from transitional height because we're surrounded by other density, by other zoning, and we're abutting into our own RE20 zone. We're seeking relief from that to make the project work at the 4 stories.
What type of construction? Is it type one, type two?
We're doing type one underground, and we're doing type five above ground. So I think it's type five construction.
And I'm not too familiar with the site. What's there currently?
Currently, there is a an old building that was a rancho market a few years ago. Rancho market has been closed out for at least 2 to 3 years, if I'm not mistaken. And then when we acquired the site back in December 2015, we had a tenant there that has been successfully evicted as of the end of last year. We had a few issues and we had to go through an eviction process for that specific tenant. But we also have, but sort of that building itself was used as a warehouse, which has now been, which is now vacant. The other thing that is using the, occupying the site is a trailer that's used by the construction company doing the street work right outside of our property. And they should be also moving out within the next month or so. They said, I think, the end of February, but it's potentially like maybe the end of March.
So the 36,000 square foot C2 zone was occupied by about approximately 10,000 square foot building, and the rest of it was surface parking. So the goal is to demolish the building. One other thing I wanted to add is that on our parking count, we're providing 66 spaces, and which is more than what we're required to provide by code. So we're parking the housing, the affordable family housing 1-to-1, and the veteran family would be half a space to one per code. And then we have some spaces left over, so we'll be providing those as well.
You guys have any questions?
No, I'm just trying to figure out where is this address.
I brought one set, so sorry.
So you didn't file anything over here with the city. There's no file in the city yet for this project. You're barely starting off right now. The process to file.
We've had conversations with the city to kind of understand what this long list of off menu and on menu incentives would look like. But our goal is to file in the next few weeks.
Okay. And are you going to be doing any kind of, digging out any kind of, okay.
Yeah.
How many yards? Right?
Oh, great. I'm on tape, aren't I?
Just wondering.
I am trying to tell you off the top of my head because we've done an air quality study.
Okay.
And I want to give you a number. And I think we're underneath the 200,000 cubic yards, which I think is the threshold. But I can actually get back to you with the addition, with the exact number. So we've done an air quality study, and there are no significant impacts. We will be hauling, but there are, yeah, the air quality study found no significant impact.
So about outreach to the people that live around there, have you done any outreach yet?
Not yet.
Not yet?
No, not yet. We have reached out to specific groups, including a group in El Sereno, out of Isai Cafe, and we have had conversations with the office of the council member. We actually had one this morning scheduled and then was canceled. It's been rescheduled already for this same week. And I don't recall the other groups, but typically what we do is a outreach process of 750 radius from the site. Although this site is a little bit like oddly shaped because of the hill in the east side, we are gonna be looking to do additional outreach, like specifically like along Huntington Drive, and then any other groups that we might identify that should hear about it. And then in the outreach process, we try to seek input for the project. This is the plan that we have right now, but we always try to incorporate any input from the community. as far as colors, as far as actual design facade. Like the number of units is kind of something that's been set, but the facade is something that we can still modify or at least try to get input from the community to get something that they're going to be kind of, that's going to be in their community.
Are you going to incorporate any public art into the project?
Not at this moment, but that's definitely something that can come out of the community outreach, community meetings. Typically, there is some type of component of like a mural or some type of art piece. Typically, the type of outreach that we do entails like three different meetings. One of them to talk about the facade, the actual project, like the incomes, the number of units. Another meeting typically around like the tenant services or the services around the veterans, so that people in the neighborhood also get familiar with who they are and get familiar with the type of population that's coming. And then a third meeting is typically around, the third meeting we try to bring back our architect and our development team to discuss and pretty much bring about the input that we have already gathered into the new design based on the feedback that we would have received from the first and second meeting. There is like this three meetings before we start construction typically. After construction, or at least at the beginning of construction, we try to do something to inform the public about how to apply for housing, including how to fill out an application, how to better prepare like their credit score, like how to, because that's like a service that we also do at ELACC, as far as how to prepare someone for like a tenancy or a contract, a lease. So that's what that is.
Let's see, are there any questions in the audience?
So you mentioned there's 90 units, that's what you proposed, 90, and all of them are gonna be affordable housing?
It's 88 that are low-income housing. There are two units that are for property management staff.
Okay.
And within the 88 units, 63 are the special needs units for veterans,
yes.
And 25 are general low-income.
But the I'm assuming the veterans are also like
they're low-income.
Low-income, income, right?
Yes.
Okay. And then you plan for it to be low-income for the entirety of its lifetime?
Typically, yes. Typically, the funding that we receive to build the project pretty much is for up to 55 years. The mission of ELACC, of course, is to maintain properties, rents to be affordable for the remaining of the life of the project.
Okay. And then you mentioned that you spoke to Eastside Cafe Group. Besides Eastside Cafe Group, like what other groups did you talk to, and what was the response or reaction of the meetings that you had with those groups?
So far, I'm so sorry. Like the outreach that has been done hasn't been done by me per se. There was a previous project manager, Mauri Rano, who was the one speaking to other groups. I can definitely get the list of those groups or those individuals for you. I don't have that list with me. Your second question was around the reaction.
Yeah, the response, and were there like any major concerns that has been brought up?
The response has been positive. So far it has been to inform the public about the project, not necessarily to get more about it. We want them to attend our future meetings. We want them to know about the project. One of the comments was about the possibility of us trying to bring a grocery store back, because that specific area doesn't have a grocery store. Unfortunately, the property right now doesn't lend itself for a grocery store the way that we have designed it. And then also the property next door, which is also affordable housing, has had they have retail built in their property that has been closed down for many years. So it's a little bit difficult for us to have develop a grocery store or any type of retail in the bottom, in the first floor, in the street level, where when we know that our neighbors are having a hard time with renting In fact, I'm not even sure that they're making any efforts to even bring in any tenants at this point. That was one of their comments, not necessarily a concern, but it was one of their comments and recommendations, if that was a possibility. Another one was to make sure that we do reach out to people in the neighborhood. We did share with them our outreach plan, and again, like, we're open to any recommendations of specific groups that we may be, that we should be targeting. So outside of door knocking of the 250 square feet radius, we do, we reach out to local organizations to send flyers. We also do one-on-ones with people, conversations for anyone that would be open or have additional questions about the project. And then we also do flyering in, like in local churches or houses of worship.
And then I was just curious, how did you come about the name Rosa de Castilla Apartments?
Rosa de Castilla came about I believe there was a river near or behind the park somehow, that in an old map of El Sereno, we found that it was called Rosa de Castilla. Typically what we do even in, within our own outreach process is name the property. So that's not necessarily going to be, it could be if people like it, of course. But that's one of the opportunities we have to for the community to have input, whether they like the name or they can change the name. We've had other properties named after someone specific that has made some type of significant in the community.
And then just as reference, Rosa de Castilla, there's an arroyo still runs Rosa de Castilla, but that one is over at Cal State LA by the 710 freeway. I believe that the arroyo that passed where your property is talking about is el arroyo de, is it the Pasa, or I have to look into it. I think it's arroyo de Pasa. Do you know who
Arroyo de Pasa, yeah.
Arroyo de Pasa, okay.
I was just curious.
This was pre my coming to the project. So I was not there in the meeting, but again, like I said, that's definitely one of the key components for every one of our projects where we've had the community give input about our projects.
You might want to consider reaching out to Preserve El Sereno. It's a group that, just stakeholders who are involved in land use issues. Their website is 90032.org, but I don't have a specific email. I know the people, but I don't know their specific information right now offhand. But I'll get to you. You have cards, by the way?
Yes, we do.
Okay.
Oh, I do.
Yeah, cards over here, right?
One thing, actually, since you were talking, the commercial came up. The queue condition is also one that's prohibiting 100% residential, so we're seeking relief from that because. As both planning and we've seen commercial doesn't work very well on that on Huntington Drive.
Right. So I noticed you said you're going to be filing shortly here. Is that to try to get ahead of Measure, or what is it, Measure S? Yeah.
No, we're ready. We've right. been ready. I think the biggest goal for ELACC is the funding, and I know Jacqueline can talk more about that.
But if, let's just say, Measure S were to pass, how would that impact your project?
Well, see, the vote is in March, so if we file in the next few weeks, we're pretty confident that our file will be deemed complete before.
And if something gets, you know, caught up and you file afterwards, would that affect your project?
No, it may.
Possibly.
Because you need a variance, correct?
For this project? Yeah, we need...
Or is it a...
We need a CUP, a site plan review, and then we need the density bonus off menu incentives.
Understood.
So, but we've been working very close with planning. In fact, some of the environmental requirements that are usually brought up after a project is filed, we've been very diligent of doing them before, so as not to lose time. So we're keeping our fingers crossed, and we're very confident that it'll be deemed complete.
And so how can we be of help to you?
Well, we're here to inform you about the project, and if there are any other groups that we should be reaching out, would like to get, names.
So I think this is a great project that you're doing, housing. Everyone talked about there's a housing crisis in California, especially among especially an affordable housing crisis, right? And so here you are building affordable housing, building it for a vulnerable population, veterans. And so I think this is a great project, great, I don't know how everybody else, you guys feel about it, but great addition to the community. So I would love for LA 32 to write a letter of support, supporting your project. How do you guys feel about this project?
I think we need to have more outreach to be done before we do anything. I think that community has to be allowed to come in and speak on what they think before we do any letters, because yeah. It hasn't been done yet. I mean, they've gone out, but not really. I mean, we don't even know what's going to be the final outcome of this, and it might be changing because they haven't even filed yet. So I'd rather wait and see what they file, what the city says, so we know exactly what we're dealing with, and what variances are going to be allowed or not allowed, and what changes that makes them do, because we don't even know the end, the final approval result. And we don't even know what people around there think about this. As a committee, you have to hear them first. I think it's important to have the outreach done so that we know where we stand.
Very good point, very good point. So here you are doing your preliminary outreach. We appreciate it. In theory, I support the project, but you know, my colleague here makes a good point. You're barely starting, haven't even filed yet. You don't have the renderings, the design isn't finalized, right?
Well, this is as final as it is for our submittal. The only thing we're seeking when we go out to the community as far as design is the actual facade. And that is because that's ELACC's mission to have our community involved in the product that we're going to be building in the community that they're going to be exposed to on a daily basis. But as far as the design, we are as complete as the planning approval project.
I would love to have this paperwork. You just mentioned all these little details about the, you know, how much, what you're seeking in CUP and you know, and housing density. You know, a copy of that on paper so that we can submit to people out there so they know and they're aware, so that they're properly informed of what's going to be taking place. Because I know that when we went to meetings for the Solar Street Bridge, and it was torn down that area, the LA Dot and Caltrans, they were so adamant about, oh no, where do we see that Rancho Market be rebuilt and be used again? So people there in that area, on those meetings are recorded, they're on YouTube, they're in the idea that that's going to be a market again. So that's why the concern is, well, do they know what's coming up and how do they feel about that?
Well, that's very helpful information, definitely.
Yeah.
Like I said, we do intend on starting our door knocking pretty soon.
Yeah.
I believe our first meeting is scheduled for the end of March, if not early April. So this is definitely something that we have in our calendar, and we intend to do our door knocking and whatever other source of media or mailers to have a meeting fairly soon, and we do intend to have the community.
So can you send these information that you just have sent, you know, already to file to us, so we could have that copy of that? All these different files that you have. I'm sure there's different files. I know there's one for, you know, variants, there's one for the plant itself, and so can you have that sent to us? We can have a copy of that?
Yeah, so when we file, the neighborhood council gets a copy of our entire package.
Oh, until you file then?
Yeah, so you will have that.
But in the meantime, maybe a fact sheet.
Yeah, we can definitely prepare that. Mm-hmm. But what's helpful for us in our filing, because it's even part of the master land use application, if we've reached out to any of the neighborhood councils or community groups, if you are comfortable in a letter of support and what was presented to you today, that would be helpful for us to have with our file, because in terms of additional research or additional outreach or how the project may change depending on what planning says, we don't know that. We don't know that until we submit the file, they set the hearing, and you know, it takes place a couple months from when we file. So we're kind of stuck in this gray ground right now where this is what we're filing, this is what our application is going to say. So this is what we're committing to the city, signing under penalty of perjury to develop. But in terms of the city's reaction, we won't know it until it's set for a hearing. And during this process, the outreach will be taking place.
But that's fine. We can definitely send you like a quick fact sheet as well as our outreach plan for your review. And again, we'll have listed groups that we have either reached out in the past or just recently. And if there's any others, we welcome any other suggestions for outreach.
All right, well, we look forward to seeing you again in the future. It sounds like we don't have enough information to write a draft letter.
If I may add on, I think that in the past, we've had developers come in person and tell us their plans. And then when it comes to file, they file something different. I'm not saying that you're going to do that, but it's just a past experience. And also, for example, we've had, you know, you're telling us you're going to have an office that's going to have office management, offices for services. We have, you know, presentation where they're going to tell us we're going to have this business is here. And then it turns out that it's going to be other stuff. And it doesn't become, you know, it's the experience in the neighborhood council sometimes hasn't been the most positive. So I think once you file with the city, I think the community would be more comfortable and the neighborhood council would be more comfortable in inviting, okay, this is an application, they know exactly what we're supporting, you know? Because I personally, as a stakeholder, I would like to know what other stakeholders think. As you said, there's 66 parking spots, so to me that seems like that might be a concern because you have the other apartments next door. And if you go there, you'll see the street is full of cars parked there. So I think the idea of the development sounds great, it's affordable housing, which is needed, but you know, what are our neighbors thinking?
I was gonna say too that if you were going to come back maybe next month, during this month, you know, that we have in between, we could do outreach for you so that we have more people here at the next meeting to live around there so that you get actual feedback. But again, they don't ask for these paperwork that I'm asking for because they don't want to see the writing. I know because in past meetings, that's what they want to see. Not that they don't believe you, but it's just the power of paperwork because that's
it's much more legitimate, right? You filed with the city, this is what you told them.
Exactly. I mean, I could tell them myself, but again, they're going to see, can I see that? They're writing, where is it online? Because, you know, they know. We've been having developers come in and they'll want to see that probably, I'm pretty sure. So.
Yep. Maybe like a two-page document with a little narrative about the project and then some facts about it. And then what you're requesting, you know, something like that. We'll help do the outreach, spread the word out, and then maybe next month when you come back, we can write a letter.
Yeah, let us know if you can. That way we could have people here. We could send out, you know, through the Facebook, social media, emails. We have email bank that, you know, we could send out and then people know this will happen. This present it again to them, and if they have questions, and we could hear it from them.
So I want to go back to my office and see if there's the time that we had scheduled for our first meeting to the community. I'm guessing that it's in March. So that's why I feel that, we absolutely welcome like more outreach. The more people we can reach out, it's obviously better. But I'm thinking that we may have to have like two meetings, one where we come to meet with your group again, and another that will actually be the community meeting. So I'm just kind of letting you know that there would possibly be an actual meeting, like a first meeting in March.
Where?
We haven't identified the location yet.
Who are you inviting? Just someone, who are you inviting to that meeting?
Again, this is out of our outreach process, okay, of our actual door knocking.
Okay, so people ready?
So, yes. Okay. So we typically do 2 days, two pretty much 8-hour days, which can be scattered between like anywhere between 2 hours per day or 6 hours a day of actual door knocking. We do the door knocking ourselves.
And do you know what date?
what date?
Yeah, the
door knocking? No, we, no, I don't know. That's why I was mentioning that. I don't have the exact date. I just know that it's in March.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for your hearing. We're going to be in the future. All right, next item.